Hi, I'm Oleg Koujikov, and you're listening to On the Health Record, a podcast somewhere at the intersection of healthcare, tech, and business. On this episode, I sat down with Dr. Alyse Sadrieh, an aesthetic foot surgeon and founder of Evo Advanced Foot Surgery. Alyse is an innovator who implements tech-forward solutions to provide the highest quality of care and top-notch patient experience. He'll tell us about the urgency of digitizing your practice, while also noting how starved the industry is for user-friendly software. He's a longtime DrChrono user with a passion for EHRs, and he shares his perspective on the essential future direction of these platforms. We'll talk about what's driving physician burnout these days, as well as Dr. Sadrieh's vision for how we can address the issue. We close with an examination of disruption in healthcare. Or at least we try. Dr. Sadrieh has a fiery stance on why the idea of disruption in healthcare is little more than tech jargon. So what would be truly disruptive? Listen through to find out. We cover a lot of ground in this one, and I came away with plenty of interesting ideas about the future of technology in healthcare. I think you will too. With that said, let's roll the tape. All right, Dr. Alyse Sadrieh started Evo Advanced Foot Surgery in 2011 and has been working with EHRs and technology even longer to get the experience of delivering healthcare just right. Alyse is a proponent for adapting tech in healthcare and business. And by the end of this interview, it should be clear just how much thought and care he puts into all of this. Alyse, welcome to the show. You're on the Health Record.
Thank you. It's nice being with you again, Oleg.
Awesome. Yeah, you said being with you again. So you have been on the show before. We're excited to have you back. But for someone listening to this for the first time, can you tell us just a little bit about yourself and what you do these days?
Absolutely. I was just speaking with somebody earlier today about this. I'm kind of a jack of all hats. So I'm by trade, I'm a foot surgeon, a podiatrist. I've been practicing for 20 years. But at the same time, since day one, I focused heavily on the integration of technology into the medical practice environment to improve the patient experience as well as the doctor's experience. And so back in 2001, when I first started practice, there was no EHR per se. I mean, there were databases that you used to run your practice and mostly centered around billing, but there wasn't like an electronic health record. Records were kept in file folders and they were kept in file cabinets. So the practice that I started at back then had the most advanced file system, so to speak. It was like a rotating cabinet, so it's compact on space, but it's still file folders, right? And so being a Mac user and being an Apple evangelist and a proponent of all things tech, I decided I'm going to start ground zero, day one, digitally. And so I had to jerry-rig my own electronic health record. I had to kind of put it together in using a Microsoft Access backend and Visual Basic. And it worked really well for the lean footprint that it had at the time. And then obviously the world evolved around us, which is a great thing. And we moved into a Mac-based EHR, which kind of fell flat on its face just because they weren't innovating quickly enough. The tool is called Mac Practice. And out of that electronic practice, so to speak, a series of opportunities showed up and engagements that I was very passionate about and excited, which blossomed into giving talks at Apple to doctors invited by the business teams across the country and talking to doctors about how to bring technology into their offices and modernize their practice flow. And along the way, DrChrono had come to birth. And so we pivoted to DrChrono because they still are, and back then were the only ones who understood the future of the healthcare informatics landscape and how relevant iOS was going to be and how important it was. Keep in mind that back then, iOS was relatively new. It was in its infancy. The iPad had just been released. And shortly thereafter, DrChrono had created their iPad iOS type interface along with their desktop, which already had the web interface. And so fast forward to today, I'm proudly still a DrChrono user. And I think if you're not living in an iPad as a practitioner, then you're doing something wrong. So we can kind of pivot into that.
Yeah, I do have like a bunch of questions about how you use your DrChrono setup and, you know, what kind of considerations you make when setting that up. But I want to start just with the outpatient clinic. You know, you run basically your own business. Can you talk about running an outpatient clinic? Why did you decide to do that? And what does it take to run one?
Absolutely. You know, there's two parallel methods, if you will, or models of practice. One is, I call it my own excuse my, layman's terms, but I call it the big box model, right? So you offload, you outsource a lot of the administrative / day-to-day business affairs to a brand, whether it's Kaiser, Cedars. Nowadays, you have these hospital models that are buying up practices and giving you all the back-end infrastructure you just practice. And that's great. Lets you focus as a physician, as a practitioner on the medicine and ignore the rest. And then there's the private practice model, the old kind of in my heart has a special place, connected, personal, my product, my business. And I tend to have some fairly critical opinions about which model serves patients best. And they're based on what the tech space takes for granted in their conversation when they're developing a product, which is user experience. And I'm sure you've heard my talks at DrChrono or at Apple maybe, or different venues that I've given talks about the PX, the patient experience, because that's no different, right? When you're using a product, whatever it is, when you hold it in your hand or you put it into use in your life, the experience that you have when you use that product is taken into consideration by the designers. And I feel that doctors, physicians have an imperative, a responsibility to curate the patient experience rather than allowing people that are not in healthcare, that are in the business of medicine, to curate that patient experience. I'm open to them collaborating with doctors, with physicians to curate the patient experience. But oftentimes it still falls flat on its face, because when you have people in the business of healthcare curating patient experience, the driving factors for them are profit motive. And oftentimes the things that we do in our practice, in our private practice, they cost money. They don't even generate profit. They generate experience, which on the back end, theoretically, will increase success, will increase monetary outcome, because people have great experience and they refer you. But so the private practice model, in my opinion, is the responsibility for most practitioners to at least attempt and keep alive. And it may not have been as easy in the in-between stages. There was the analog stage, which was purely paper-driven, right? And so you practiced with just a very simple chart, and maybe your name was in the yellow pages and you had a referral network and patients came to see you. And then you have the current model, which is highly tech dependent. And in between was a little bit challenging. But today, there's really no excuse not to be in private practice, because the tools are all there. All the SaaS tools are there, software as a service. So things like DrChrono, things like patient engagement platforms, things like PACS, radiographic imaging solutions, testing solutions, all of it. I mean, it's so deep. It's so multifaceted that today is the best time ever for a doctor, a physician to have their own space and their own practice, their own brand, and provide a curated experience. And we're seeing that pop up more and more in the new generation, so to speak, the younger, more tech-savvy doctors, and leveraging tools.
Well, you know, you say that you've been doing this for a long time. You've been sort of thinking about that patient experience. And what's it like for a patient coming into my clinic? I imagine since you started, maybe even before you started Evo, tell us about it. Like, how have you set up DrChrono in your office in terms of the patient experience and also your experience of delivering care?
Thank you. So I have, and it's like everything else, it's an iterative experience. It's an iterative process. You can't expect to have the answer day one. It has to evolve, hence the name Evo for the practice. Then I rebranded the practice into Evo in 2011. And the premise of the rebranding was that we had the location, the new location, and it was my 10-year anniversary in practice. And I decided, okay, we're leaning heavy into the tech. We're transitioning. All the pieces were in place now. DrChrono was now mature and a usable product. It was like out on the App Store. Mm-hmm. And so why not just kind of lean in heavily into the new version of the practice facing the future? And I say this, I just said this recently with some of your team members on a call, that I consider DrChrono, tools like DrChrono, but particularly DrChrono, as the operating system for our product. Let's pause for a minute and take a look at our iPhones or Androids. But if you're an Android user out there, please, please, please convert to your iPhone. Come on, just call me up. I'll tell you why. I'll give you all the fundamental reasons why. So if you look at this device in your hand, really what this device is a series of elements that came out of the earth: lithium, aluminum, glass, silica, silicone, plastics, different metals, and all reformatted into the construct that can be put together into a device called the iPhone. But it's useless without an operating system. It's just a hunk of materials. The OS is what makes the experience of the iPhone complete, not to devalue the engineering and the design behind the usability of the actual form factor, the way it feels in your hand, what it does for you in your day-to-day life, how you engage with it physically. But really, the magic of the iPhone is when you turn it on, right? Initially, it was swipe to open, and now it's swipe up. But so that right there captures the magic of it, swipe to open. Because those of us who are old enough to remember our cell phones, it wasn't about a swipe. It wasn't about a gesture. And so why this matters is that the experience that a user has using a device like an iPhone, I translate into what it means for them to come into the practice. I look at the practice, this call of the box, the physical location, as a large computer. So you've got the structure, the space, the walls, the furniture, the layout, the architecture, right? Then you've got the chairs and you've got the actual people. But what's the OS? What's the software for this beautiful box? So much akin to the dead iPhone without an OS. A practice without a software, an experience that is related to engagement with the practice, with the people that work in the practice on a software level, is just a dead box. I mean, sure, you'll consume the healthcare. You'll consume the product. The doctor will solve the problem for you. But in today's world where everything leans on tech, I mean, just a day ago, we all saw the release of Amazon's Astro Dog, right? And a few months ago, weeks ago, Tesla announced their ambitions to create the Tesla bot, leveraging their AI technology and Tesla vehicles. And all the AI and all the software and all the technology that's around us, some of it is in the background like your AirPods, some of it's right in your face like the OS in your laptop or your phone or your iPad. So software is critical in your life experience today in 2001. It makes your life experience in the modern world. So that's why the correct electronic health record is critical. Because if you're running your computer on DOS or Windows 3.1 or Windows 95 or Windows XP, I mean, think about it for a second, how clunky that must be for you. You can technically, right? You take your patient records in Microsoft Word and 3.1 and it just does the trick. You type it out and you print it out and you put it in a folder. We're not even acknowledging all the laws that have come into place to compel doctors to use electronic health records that are compliant with the regulatory guidance. But imagining for a second, if you could stay in that old world, you create a primitive experience for your patient and a limited experience for your patient. Because today, as evidenced by tools like Apple Health, patients expect their information and they expect their engagement to happen fluidly from their phone. You know, I pick up my phone, I swipe up, I open up Instagram, I message, I share something with a friend. I get something from a friend. I get a shared album in iPhoto, in photos from someone. I share notes that we can collaborate on. I mean, think about all the great things that I can do from this device, this multipass in my hand. This has become my exobrain. And so practitioners, doctors, which are supposedly and supposed to be the polymaths, the most advanced or the most highly educated of society historically, staying behind that ball is a problem. And it's a factor of multiple things that we can get into maybe in different discussions, but it has to happen. And so DrChrono, tools like DrChrono, but particularly DrChrono, really, I have this hobby. I spent most of the last maybe 6 years investigating EHRs. I have a couple of dummy Google accounts, Gmail accounts, Alias accounts, and I'll send out emails interested in their EHRs. And you know, their sales reps will get on a video call with me and they'll demo the app because one of their most, actually almost all of them, except for DrChrono, the Achilles heel is what? Is the barrier for entry. I can't demo the product. I can't see the product. I can't play with the product. I need to deal with a salesperson first, which is a problem for someone like me. With DrChrono, you can just download the app and make a login and start using it. Sales team will follow up with you and tell you about the different plans available, but you can start using the app, the simple version of it, without any barrier for entry. That right there was magical. That's a big kudos to the DrChrono team and the founders. And so being able to digitize your practice at your leisure, at home, in your pajamas, laying in bed on your iPad is right there is a really special thing. And so incorporating this technology into the practice, allowing patients to easily interact with the practice, communicate with the practice, have their records available to them in their phone, make an appointment from their phone, chat with the doctor's office from their phone. That is very powerful and important and actually kind of mission critical in today's world, 2021. I feel like if you're not doing that in 2021, whether you're a big box institution, and a lot of them have attempted it, and by the way, the bigger they are, the less inspired and the less quality their product is. I remember I'm a patient too, right? So I go places as a patient. And I recently had an experience at Cedars. I had an experience at USC Keck. And they're great institutions, incredible physicians, great people. It's the staff, everyone's just doing their best. But the infrastructure that they're dealing, that they're working inside of, it's the behemoth infrastructure. It's the Microsoft style development, the Boeing or the GM. You know, we all see how big box brands like that develop. They don't develop from an inspired, nimble, beautiful experience. They develop just to get the job done. And so whenever I have to log into my USC Keck portal, I cringe at the interface and I cringe at the user experience. It gets the job done, sure, but it's clunky. It's not liquid and beautiful, what I get on my iPhone and any other app that I use, whether it's Twitter, whether it's obviously the big ones, Instagram, or something as finite or outside there like Calendly or GoodNotes. I mean, the list is long. I'm sure we have lots and lots of apps on our phones. So the point of a company like DrChrono and our usage is that the patient's experience when they're in their device is analogous to what they're used to using in other well-developed apps in their iPhone and their iPad. I feel like I didn't answer your question. Specifically, DrChrono is a major contributor to our fluidity for our patients to be able to connect with us in the practice, schedule with us, have access to their records, which technically is the law now. There's a law that passed recently that requires patients to have access to the records. And not only is DrChrono allowing or making it easier for you to do that, but they went even one step further. They're one of a handful of platforms, of tools that connect directly with Apple Health. And that is magical because now not only are you able to share the records with the patient and the patient is able to share their health data with you, that opens up a world of data to the doctor in a beautiful interface designed by Apple. Activity data, lab data, watch data. I mean, whatever they choose to share in their health collection, you get to see on the doctor's side, but you can share with the patient as it rolls out in stages. If that's not the writing on the wall that you have to sign up for the future, then I don't know what is.
Yeah, no, I'd say you did answer my question early, like that this process or this experience is something you iterate on. It's not something like distinct. You're not looking for one thing. And generally what you're looking for is bringing a 21st century or modern or whatever the word is, experience, the experience we're used to in other areas. You want to bring that also to your clinic, to healthcare. So I got my answer, and just hearing you talk about like all of this and the way you look at it was very interesting. Let's take a quick break. And when we get back, we'll talk about how these EHRs that we have, how they can grow. So software is this amazing thing. It's like no other product in that it's constantly being tinkered with and improved on even after you buy it. So you mentioned this as someone who doesn't just use DrChrono, but you've actually worked with many EHRs. You sort of see the field and not just one piece of it. What in your mind is the biggest opportunity for growth when it comes to EHRs?
This is a very good question and a very deep question. And I think the upcoming transition for EHRs, the biggest opportunity to growth, it's going to be an abstract answer, so brace yourself.
I'm ready.
Is to get out of the way.
Okay.
Get out of the way. See, here's the thing. Doctors, by far, are some of the busiest people that I know, myself included. Especially once in private practice, it's much easier when you're at a place where you can just hunt for you and all you have to do is focus on the healthcare. But if you're practicing a private practice model, which I made the argument earlier, is at least an imperative for most of us to hold on to, because the moment you give away the farm, you can't bring it back, right? So I do fundamentally believe that that is one of the, there are a lot of authorities talk on this, a lot of really great people out there, Jay Parkinson being one of them, one of the leaders in the medical tech space that that I've had communications with over the past, and a cool guy. But so in the private practice model, with all of the things that you're responsible for, especially if it's your own private practice, you don't have any partners, you face this newly emerged topic that we're talking about, a burnout. You've got to keep up with your records. That's the most important and the most challenging thing. And you have to keep up with the business aspect of it. And the billing, is just an ominous monster, because I think you and I talked about this, and I definitely, like usual, got off track, but the insurance companies don't make it easy for the private practitioner, because they're in the business of profit. They're in the business to make money. So the only way to do that is to pull in as much as they can of the control of the private practice and to add to their coffers. So when that game continues around you, now you've got billing as a monster to deal with. It's not as simple as let's say you had a restaurant. That's a transactional relationship. You come in, I have a fixed cost, and then I have some flexible costs. You come in, you consume the product, you pay for it, I'm in business. And the practice is different. And so all of those stressors, and then lay on top of that, this not well thought out, not well designed electronic health record framework. There's so many of them. I can't tell you how many I've played with over the years. And you're adding a stressor. A, rule number one, don't ever get a record or any kind of SaaS solution that requires a support system. The less support you need, the better off you are. And you kind of feel that right away when you onboard into DrChrono. There's a lot of SaaS solutions that people have used. And one that I make an example of that has a heavy lifting when it comes to the learning curve is like Zendesk. Zendesk is so complicated and so hard. I mean, you really have to be an expert. You have to or Salesforce, there's courses you go to learn how to use these things. They're great tools, but getting into that world is you're diving into this ocean of information, and who wants to get out of that, right? Once you're in it, you're stuck in it. That's kind of like their business model, if you will. DrChrono is not like that. It's super lean. And these are not just first of all, I don't work for DrChrono. I don't get paid for this. This is a totally non-relationship conversation. I'm just a believer. I believe my responsibility as a physician, as a doctor, as a surgeon, is to purvey the best information to my colleagues and to the world out there. So I have proof of this. The proof is in my surgical facility, my surgery center, we utilize occasionally a nursing service that sends us nurses that we kind of, it's like an Uber, click on it. The nurse picks up the job. They show up the next day. And they're all licensed and, vetted. And basically the nurse is there to do the nursing care for the patient while they're recovering, while they're waking up from surgery. Well, these people have never been in our facility before. Some of them have, some of them are repeats. So I had an experiment on the newest nurse, right? They just come in first time. And I was like, oh, so here's our EHR system. You just pick up this iPad, just go on the red appointment. That's the surgery appointment. And you'll figure it out. Just fill out the forms that are in the additional tab that say nursing. That's all I gave them. That's the onboarding. That's the training for the nurse. She's never touched DrChrono. She's never used DrChrono. And guess what? They do the chart perfectly. There's no support. There's no training. There's no grooming. Now, there are some givens here, some premises that we're taking for granted. One is that I have curated and built a quality template, a smart, intelligent template, leveraging the tools that DrChrono gives me, which are super simple. Anybody can figure it out. In fact, a lot of our templates in the office are designed by our team members, prior neurosurgical technologists or my associates who aren't very tech savvy. And so the idea is that you want a system that doesn't create dependency on support. That is critical. That eliminates the burnout, number one, because you're not constantly fixing this fire and putting out that fire and solving this and solving that. Number two is the system that, this is a future of EHRs and what they should be looking out for is to get out of the way. The less interaction I have with your EHR to create a well-crafted documentation of my experience with the patient, the better off I am as a practitioner, because I'm spending more time with my patient and less time tapping buttons on the screen. Now, that opens up the conversation into the iPad versus desktop laptop world. And I'm a big, big, big proponent of the iPad world, because there was an interview with Tim Cook a while back. I think it was with the Wall Street Journal. And in the interview, they were talking about, I think they had just come out with the new iPads, the new iPad Pros, the new form factor with Face ID. And he was saying how he spends 80% of his time in an iPad and 20% of his time behind other types of computing devices like a laptop or a desktop. And this is the CEO of the largest corporation in the world, right? $1 trillion company. I think now multi-trillion dollar company. And the takeaway from that for me is that, look, if you just wrap your mind around the new paradigm of engagement, of interaction with data, which is the iPad, you're going to make your life simpler, easier, and you're going to improve engagement with whoever you're working with in whatever model working. In the medical environment, it couldn't be more true. Because who likes to go into a treatment room and you're sitting there and I've got a computer, I ask you a question, I turn my back to you and I type. I ask you a question, I turn my back to you and you type. Now, there are a lot of tools coming out, like Nuance has this background dictation. So it's just listening to the conversation and transcribing for you. And I can see where AI and the transcription of the conversation has power. But still, my dashboard, my interaction point is a tablet. That's the intelligent format, not the keyboard, not the screen, the tablet. Because there's an intimacy when I'm sitting next to a patient and I've got this tablet in hand and I can pull up a diagram and I can draw on it next to them rather than I can lecture to them from a screen in front of them, let's say, by sharing screen from my laptop to it or an x-ray board for that matter. That intimacy of sitting next to someone with a tablet in my hand and drawing on it, that's powerful. And there's many ways to do that. You can draw into different tools, but why not just draw in the chart, right? And that's the pen input and the iPad native aspect of DrChrono gives you that power. Any document, anything inside the chart, you can just write on naturally. And isn't that funny how now finally with the iPad's evolution maturity, Apple's finally caught up with that. DrChrono's been doing that for a long time. We can just draw on anything, write on anything, right? Apple's finally saying, hey, look, you know, with the new, what do they call it, the Freenote or the note app in the side, all of these little nuances to be able to use your Apple Pencil effectively and quickly. So getting out of the way for an EHR is the future of the EHR. In the background, transparent, where it doesn't get in between me and the patient, doesn't get in between my workflow, is simple to put into use. Templates are readily and easily available for me to make, and they're less interaction, less work intensive, and simple to engage with. I think that that is the holy grail, because that's going to solve a lot of the burnout. I think the majority of what we hear in the conversation of burnout for doctors is records related. It's keeping notes. Notes are hard to do nowadays.
I have some stats on this. Physicians in the United States spend roughly 90 minutes in their EHR taking notes, filling orders, sending messages, and doing clinical review. That compares to about 60 minutes per day in other countries like Canada, Northern Europe, Western Europe, and the Middle East. They also spend more time after hours in their EHR, 26.5 minutes a day compared to 19.5 minutes per day. This extra time spent in the EHR, it could be interpreted as a sign that, you know, burnout is especially hard for American doctors. What are your thoughts on this? And is there, you've already told me, get out of the way, but is there anything we can do to improve the experience and the time spent inside EHRs?
Yes, I think it's multifactorial, actually. Like, I think the American doctor versus other doctors is not just EHR related. That's part of it. That's definitely part of it. You're cluing into something important. It's more than that, though. It's also the model of healthcare. And I don't necessarily agree with there's a lot of rhetoric around this. And unfortunately, like most of the topics that are discussed in today's world, that rhetoric has an intention, there's an angle to it. And if you look at it, really kind of see through the weeds for a second, you'll see that most of it is polluted with that angle. The truth is, if you zoom out and look at the overarching philosophy and the responsibility of medicine and healthcare, the only model that works, the only model that's correct is low volume, high quality. I'm a believer in healthcare for all. I believe in that. I think healthcare, it makes sense on multiple facets, okay? A modern civilized society should have healthcare available for all of its citizenry. That's just kind of a no-brainer. It keeps the citizen and the workforce healthy, which means it's productive for companies. It's why companies like Amazon are leaning into health services available for their employees, Google. I mean, this is something that's been around for a while, right? On campus healthcare. And so healthcare for all is important. But the thing is this, now we have to ask ourselves, remember, physicians, the bearers of Prometheus' torch, the polymaths, the intellectuals of society, so to speak, not just workers. I mean, if doctors are becoming a commodity, they're just becoming factory workers, I think we're in trouble. And so if that's the case, if that's who we are, which is the polymath intelligent members of society, then is high volume, low quality health or medium quality health acceptable, or low volume, high quality health? Which is more beneficent? Because at the end of the day, healthcare is about you and me in the room. One of my mentors said this to me. He said, these four walls, referring to the treatment room, are magic, because what happens in here is intimate. It's special. People trust you in here. They're vulnerable in here. So I personally subscribe to the low volume, high quality model. I always have, and I'm leaning into that heavily with our next rendition of Evo. And unfortunately, the business of healthcare doesn't care about that. The business of healthcare is about, there was a recent article, CEO of United Healthcare was saying with CNBC, and he was proud of saying that United Healthcare is going to be a $100 billion company this year. Well, how does that happen? And I comment on this publicly on Twitter. I mean, it's a big thing for me. Well, how that happens is they reduce reimbursements and increase premiums, which means increased volume, because reduced reimbursements means doctors see more people. So in order for you to embrace this low volume model, you have to chisel away at it little by little. One way is to improve your workflow and decrease the amount of time that you're wasting, so to speak, on systems that are archaic and not designed well. Typing is just so inefficient. Typing just shouldn't happen. And with DrChrono, you don't have to type. Now, marry DrChrono with the new, and I just had a conversation with one of your co-founders about this maybe a few hours ago. Marry DrChrono, because I'm very proud of your company for doing this. You leaned in heavy on making sure you develop DrChrono for the iPhone as well. So I spend maybe 50% of my time doing my notes on my phone. That's crazy, right? My records. Mm-hmm. I'm doing full-on medical records from a phone, and I'm not typing a word. How? Well, the same interface, the same click interface, template interface is available on the phone. It's actually easier to use because the buttons are closer, so you can just do one finger tapping. And what's rad is with the iPhone 13, the new processor, the A15X processor, oh my gosh, I pretty much talk to my phone all the time now. I rarely type into it. And the Apple's built-in dictation system is just, with the new processor, is flawless. It's flawless, 100%. I never have to correct anything. It's just flawless. So now what happens all of a sudden? Now I'm living in the dictation world. I don't have to pay for a service to have something recording in the background, and I can just talk to my phone quickly and the note's in there, right? So that's kind of like the saving time, getting out of the way. What does that mean? That means I can take 2 hours that I'm spending tapping away, typing away, and spend it with patience, reducing the volume, reducing the quality. So I think comparing the European models to the American models is a little bit unfair, because they have this static kind of structured model where doctors aren't necessarily in private practice. It's a, if we use the word loosely, but socialized healthcare model. And as Americans, I think we're adamant about not having that. We like our privatized healthcare system because we like options. We like consumer ability to choose and shop. And I personally agree with that, because that allows for excellence to show itself. And instead of being a stagnant model, and the way to really do that, again, it all boils down to the HR. Part of it is a business discussion. It's a insurance in and out of network conversation that is prolonged, and more than happy to have it at one point in time. It's not in the context of this conversation. I think from the EHR perspective, the way you do it is get rid of your pain point, move into an iPad. You don't need this huge, clunky, text-based, uninspired drop-down menu nonsense. I mean, it's just, some of these EHRs I've tested and played with are just like painful. And there's a big one. We won't say its name. It's a huge one. It's the one that pretty much every mainstream hospital like infrastructure uses. And, you know, locker room talk, every doctor that I'm with, they complain about it, because it's the gorilla, right? That's just sitting there. And it's like and let's think about how those happen. Why are all the big box hospitals using this one system? Well, because who makes the decision to use it? The purchasing department, the IT guys, the tech guys. And who are they? Well, funny enough, they use iPhones in their personal lives or iPads. You know, they love, their kids have iPads. They have iPads. They enjoy their Apple TV. But when it comes to the hospital, they're kind of like in a track. They're in a healthcare IT track. And so the purchasing of an EHR is done based on the corporate business discussion and what's the best experience for our doctor's perspective. So I'm eagerly awaiting the day that DrChrono penetrates into the hospital market. That would be really exciting to see and just takes that over, because I think it's long overdue for the big players to disappear. They don't get it.
Wow. All right. I have one more question here about EHRs. You know, you mentioned a litany of drop-down menus. EHRs have a pretty broad job these days. EHRs do everything from scheduling to note-taking, sending and collecting forms, ordering labs, record vitals, file your claims, process your claims. The list goes on and on. In your mind, what's the most important thing for an EHR to do and do it well?
Get out of the way. And oh, like one more question. I've got so much more to say.
Oh, man.
No.
Before the break, I meant. But yeah, in what way do you mean that?
I think the number one thing for an EHR to do is to, you mean like literally task related, like the one task that matters most for us?
Yeah.
I'm going to answer it abstractly, like I've done the majority of my 50 years on this planet. I'm just an abstract being. So that answer is to unification. The most important thing EHRs can do well is unification. It eliminates that litany of drop-down menus you discussed. It eliminates the complications and challenges behind the billing process. Most EHRs, DrChrono included, it's not a bad thing. It's just how the nature of the business is and the nature of the development world. You've got subspecialists in each sector. You've got the RCM people, right? The collections billing people. You've got the engineers. You've got the salespeople. You've got some of the designers. You've got the product mapping and product managers. And they all kind of come together and they piecemeal together this vision of what this tool can do. Much like what happens with a Salesforce or a Slack or any of these big platforms that people are using today. Apple, you know, Mac OS. And the issue, as evidenced by anybody who does any tech reading for a hobby and is an enthusiast about the history of tech, is that these departments rarely talk with one another. And the glue between these things, when they become excellent, like most of our mentor from afar, Steve Jobs's role as a visionary, is to connect them. The visionary connects these pieces together, right? And the unification and connection between these pieces, so they become one cohesive organism, is, I know that I'm not answering your question saying like, oh, well, you know, the most important thing is note taking. The most important thing is scheduling. No, that's like saying the most important thing on your iPhone is the calendar or is contacts or is the phone. Is it? The iPhone is, as Steve said it, this blank slate for developers to draw on and procure your vision. So it's the vision, the cohesive connection between all these pieces and how they operate. And I think the EHR that finally does that between the pieces of what the EHR world offers, i.e. scheduling, billing, patient engagement and communication. Heck, I haven't seen one yet. Imagine for a second integrating marketing into an EHR. Thinking about integrating so we have a tool like that. So in our practice, we leverage, because we're kind of outside the box, we leverage a tool called Haymarket. And Haymarket, like many other tools, is a multi-channel communication tool, allowing you to get inputs from all of your messaging platforms, Instagram, Facebook, WhatsApp, Google, Apple Maps, set up Apple Business Chat. They message you, boom, it shows up in your chat Haymarket. So you're sitting here, everyone's sitting in their different silos and you're messaging them all. Why shouldn't that be in the EHR? I mean, of course it should, right? So that's the thing, unification of all of these different resources into one little beautiful bubble around the patient. Because that's how I see the patient. The patient is this little cloud of information. Visualize the little cloud of information just walking around each person. And that cloud of information has some personal data, has some healthcare data, and that it varies over time. So if an EHR can unify that into a beautiful interactive platform, engagement platform for the user, the doctor, I think that is the most important tool, the unification aspect of it. Because each piece, I mean, like, for instance, as evidenced by the fact that you can purchase, you can license DrChrono as a user in the different levels that it's offered, right? And I forget the nicknames you guys have given them, but ironically and serendipitously, they're all, I think the names of like Greek gods or Greek names, which is how I name my devices. I think that's kind of fortuitous. And so I buy, let's see, if I buy the Apollo plan or if I buy the, I forget what the first level is called.
Hippocrates.
But, there you go, Hippocrates plan. And so really what you're saying by offering these different levels, these different tiers of your platform is you're saying, well, look, you can run your product on different levels. You don't need all of it. So what that does for me is it says, maybe telehealth isn't critical in my practice, but billing is. Maybe billing isn't critical, but patient chat is. Maybe patient chat isn't, but scheduling is. Or maybe I don't even use DrChrono to take notes. Maybe I use a voice text inside of Pages and then I PDF that and use it as an attachment to DrChrono, right? There's so many ways to do this. I think it all goes away when an EHR focuses on unification. And that's what I spend most of my time contributing to if I have the privilege of working with people like DrChrono and contributing like vision, if you will, of like, hey, listen, guys, this is what's around the corner, right? And honestly, like today, I think 2021, the only platform that does that close to that is DrChrono. Just it is. That's it. It's got this, you know, app ecosystem. Maybe that's the infant version of what I'm saying. The fact that you can, it's this modular API driven ecosystem where other developers can create great tools that plug in and unify with this awesome EHR. And you have a quasi seamless experience. I consider DrChrono still in its infancy. It's the best tool, but it's still early in the EHR world for it to show its true potential and power. And definitely has flexed a lot of muscle up to now. So I think that, you know, on a like an end user, a new doctor or an established doctor, and they just want to simplify their life. It's like, okay, good. Get rid of all your, first of all, I have to say this because I have the opportunity to say this. If you're listening out there and you're running on a local database in your office, we need to talk. We need to talk. That's got to go away. I'm OS 10 server certified. I literally went and got educated in how to run OS 10 server and set up my own. I had a multi-RAID, super advanced server system in my office that I managed myself with user accounts, you name it. This is back in 2007. And I was so excited when I could finally just move into the cloud. And people are like, and there's so many, I'm a talker. So it's like, you know, what about the cloud's reliability? And what about this? And what about that? I was like, none of those happen. Here's the pearl. You've got an iPad. You've got 6 iPads in your office. You get a business account from your cellular provider. You put a SIM card in each one. You're running cellular. You don't care about if your internet goes down or not. Doesn't matter. It's irrelevant. Each iPad is connected. And now if you're running a VoIP system in your iPad and your phone is in the iPad with an AirPod connected to it, you don't even need a phone system. Your practice just became super modern. No phone system. Everyone's got their phone in their iPad. Got an AirPod, an iPad. You've got your EHR in there. Each user in your office has a camera now so they can document stuff on the patient while the patient goes through the process. With new iOS, they can scan data from the camera. I mean, look at the world we live in, right? So more and more, when I've been saying this phrase for a while, which is your EHR is the operating system, what we started out with for your practice. It's the OS for your box, for your machine. More and more, that's becoming a truth. And I don't know, you know, it's funny, in these tests that I do with these EHRs, when I kind of email them with the Alyse accounts and kind of go through demos, one question that always brings cripples every single one. There isn't one that can answer this question correctly. Not one, except for DrChrono. Do you have an iPad native app? Fail. And here's, they start stumbling, the reps, the sales reps. Well, no, we have an iPad optimized web app. Like, it's designed for an iPad. That's not what I asked you. I said, do you have an iPad native app? No one does. Because they look at the iPad as this like fringe thing, right? This tool, rather than the place to live, which really is what it is. See, someday, 5, 10, whenever it is years from now, somebody will listen to these guys predicted it. It's really the truth. The iPad is the place to live.
All right. Well, it wasn't the answer I was expecting, but I really feel like I learned a lot there. And I think probably the question, the way I asked the question was probably, it set it up not for success, but
it was a great question. You're a great interviewer.
Thank you so much. Okay. We're going to take a break here. And when we get back, we'll talk about disruption in healthcare. So we're back. To close this out, I wanted to talk about disruption in healthcare. It's this huge topic. You've probably heard of it. Healthcare is a huge, huge, huge part of our economy. We put a lot of money into healthcare. It's also one of the biggest places that's rife for disruption, I think is what people say. So let's start with, well, I'll let you pick. You want to start with promising stuff or failures?
I want to start with something abstract. So here's the thing, disruption. Like, I just don't like that term. That term is coming from college students who want to prove themselves in the world and put their flag in and say, like, it came out of, you know, the early tech space, the early 2000s, the Facebooks of the world, like disruption.
Right.
No,
right.
I'm sorry. You're not going to disrupt my world. No, we're
physicians. They had a whole conference. Yeah.
We're physicians. We hold the torch. We are the ones who get, that's the problem. We're commoditizing doctors, turning them into workers. And then other people are coming back saying, we're going to disrupt healthcare. What do you know about healthcare? We are healthcare. We and the patients are healthcare, right? And so it should be collaboration, and the word disruption should change to evolution. There's no need to. Healthcare doesn't operate. Look, if we operated on disruption, then a lot of what you hear about these fearful claims about vaccines and all the stuff that's happening in the world of, like, you know, fake news or bogus stuff about healthcare, then that would be valid, because it's like, well, disruption. Let's create something totally new. I know. Let's break an egg on someone's broken knee and then rub olive oil on it. And that's going to disrupt the way we heal broken knees. That's not how healthcare works. That's not how science operates. Science works on iterative evolution. You guys don't do disruption when it comes to engineering. You evolve. You take your platform and you add to it. You subtract from it. And you layer on technologies that work over time. So we're going to change the word to evolution in healthcare, because that's going to empower all the listeners and the people that are making tools for healthcare. And the next evolutionary step in healthcare, obviously AI, that's just a no-brainer. I mean, that's just the low-hanging fruit. It's there. And AI is really going to save us from ourselves as a species, right? Because it's engineered around one thing, optimizing and theoretically eliminating fish meat. I mean, you can see that in the drive already. Imagine for a second, if all cars communicate each other with a high-speed network, and the information was put in by the patient, by the user, the driver, which my car, I drive a Tesla Model Y. So it's like my calendar is synced with my car. When I get in my car, it knows where I want to go. So it's already loaded in my navigation. So imagine the world where these cars are communicating with each other. And so now what happens? They don't have a greedy desire to beat the other guy, change this lane just because they want to, because they perceive going faster. They're optimizing how to get there. And so all of a sudden, traffic disappears. Think about it. Is there any traffic in your vessels, in your blood vessels? How many billions of red blood cells are moving quickly in your blood vessels and there's no traffic? Right? And so the reason is because there's no shoving and pushing and cutting and so using the analogy AI example in healthcare, it's going to lubricate and speed up the process. Currently, the closed silos of information, which is changing because of government laws, which are great, and players like DrChrono and Apple, which are great, allowing for this interoperability and open access to data. But once that really blossoms into its mature form, we'll use the word disruption here, but it's not, it's an evolution. That's going to be the evolutionary process that's going to save healthcare from itself, because you, as the data silo that we referenced earlier, go to Dr. A for problem one. And Dr. A decides, okay, so I'm going to order these tests, and they do. And Dr. B is now recruited. Dr. B has immediate access to that information. There's no records request. There's no repeat testing. Mm. I mean, just think about the power of open sourced information, right? The issue with that becomes, well, and in a way I understand it, it's like, well, I want to use it in my system, you use it in your system. So the regulators, which is kind of like the worst way of doing this, honestly, it's happening because we never, in the last 15 years, we haven't had a visionary build a healthcare system that's just so incredible that the regulators didn't create the rules for the interoperability of the platforms out there. Mm-hmm. But because, you know, regulators mean government, right? And so, I mean, honestly, tell me one thing that the government's created that's beautiful. Like, is the DMV an exemplary model of the user experience? Is the post office? I mean, no, really, seriously. Is the IRS or any of the government institutions? I love them all. They're all great. Thank goodness we have them. But are any of them like an exemplary model of user interface and user experience? They're not. They're government. And government is like lowest common deliverable. I mean, look at TSA, anything that's out there, governmental, is just kind of low deliverable, like get the job done. And the iPhone's not that. The iPhone is delicious. Who doesn't love their iPhone? So I think that there's a, so if we want to use the word disruptive, let's do that. The next disruption in healthcare, in the healthcare IT space, information technology, is an EHR that people love. That's disruption. That's a good goal for you guys. I love DrChrono. I mean, I could love it more, but I love DrChrono. That's disruption. Create something that doctors love to use. They're like, oh yeah. If you can get doctors to feel the way they do about their iPhones, about their EHRs, that's disruptive.
Well, I didn't even have AI on here. I had some other buzzwords, and now I'm going to be very careful tiptoeing around these words because you're so right. I mean, the way we use disruption compared to what we could call it, it's right. It doesn't make a lot of sense. But I have some other, I came here with some ideas.
So I mean, telehealth, wearables. Yeah, telehealth, wearables, those things, those are good. But those, consider those like baseline infrastructure items that, I mean, I've been doing telehealth for like, since, I didn't even know how long I've been doing telehealth. Telehealth since video was available. Or the government to tell me to do telehealth. I just did it. And HIPAA, okay, here's how HIPAA is. You sign a waiver. You sign an agreement. As the patient, you own that right. Yes, I want to do this. I want you to email me my information. I understand the risks. I want you to get on a video. Now, fortunately, we have HIPAA infrastructures and compliance systems, so we can do that without having to do that. Mm-hmm. But the idea is that the responsibility falls, this goes back to the very beginning of our discussion, on the doctor. And when you defer your private practice ability to a big box, you just gave that up. It's over. Now you're depending on the big box to build that for you. You're just going to do the medicine. And so wearables, that's freaking rad. We experimented with wearables like back in 2010, I think it was 2011, when Fitbit was in its heyday. We implanted Fitbits into the bottom of our surgical shoes. Our patient signed a waiver. I bought 15 Fitbits and I keep track of them. They were labeled and we had our little docs there and we had different accounts for each one. And we knew what patient got what based on their EHR, DrChrono. We had a little field and they came in for their post-op. We synced the Fitbit and we know how much activity they had. This is 2011, pre-Apple Watch, right? Yeah. It's cool. And so wearables are definitely the future. But that's not like disruptive. Okay, so telehealth, video, whatever. Yeah, sure, great, fantastic. Telehealth, I just did a pre-op with the telehealth visit today. It's great, but I can't do a post-op with a telehealth visit. I mean, there's things that you still want people to touch you. That's why malls will... You ever wonder why magazines still exist and newspapers? Like, why are magazines flourishing? Print is still flourishing. Because we're human, we're analog beings. We love touching things. We love to sit with each other. That's why everyone's getting depressed with COVID. We love to see. So telehealth is going to solve, let's say, maybe, I don't know the percentage, whatever percentage it is, but it's a percentage of healthcare's challenges. In-person is really the thing that is always going to exist in medicine. It just is. Until maybe the long-term future where robotic medicine can, like, we can deploy a van that the robot comes to your house and like remotely fixes your body parts, right? That's a ways out. So zooming back into today, I think the disruption is AI. I'd love to see some AI. I think it's on the radar, but AI and DrChrono and making my life a lot easier because it's just in the background. I also think, just because I have the forum, DrChrono, if they're allowing someone else to do the AI with the API thing, I think that would be a bit of a concern for me because it's like, well, then you guys become backseat to that. You know, I think DrChrono should be the leader in that aspect.
Okay. Well, I'm going to scrap wearables, telehealth. You've already, I guess I had like one little question and maybe it's just a yes or no answer. If Google Glasses like didn't work, is there any chance for the new Ray-Ban and Facebook project?
No.
I didn't think so.
Come on. Oh, I think you know me well enough where you know that I can't do small answers. There's an old Chinese...
I'm just trying to get you riled up.
I love that. There's an old Chinese proverb, okay? The wrong man using the right means makes the right means work in the wrong way. The wrong man using the right means makes the right means work in the wrong way. I'll leave it at that.
Yeah. Well said.
But that technology, that concept, oh, dude, that's a killer. I was really super enthusiastic about I still have Microsoft's like Holodeck or I forget what it's called because I haven't really had access to interact with it. But I think AR, along with AI, I think AR is very well together. And we see that with our iPhones. The iPhone is a very interesting AR tool, right? I think I commend Apple for their ethical, thoughtful, slow, deliberate, no matter how much the press and the pundits and the YouTubers want to pummel Apple for being slow to market. I think it's highly commendable for Tim and his team that they're sticking to the original philosophy of Apple. They're thoughtful, they're inclusive, they're deliberate, they're focused on wellness in the right way. Look at accessibility. Accessibility in the Mac and the iPhone and the iPad is unbelievable. If nobody's ever dove into like accessibility, do so. Because accessibility opens up so many tools for you, even if you don't need accessibility, if you don't have any handicaps in life. And I think the thoughtful implementation of AI and AR are going to empower humanity and improve the quality of life for everyone. And so in the context of healthcare, I think AR is the next, if you're asking about the glasses conversation, it's the next. I mean, I can just see it in surgery right now. Imagine AI dovetailed with AI, but AR would dovetail with AI. Let's say glasses. I'm in surgery. I'm looking at something and it's rapidly identifying everything for me and outlining the anatomy before I'm doing anything with my hands, right? That's cool.
Yeah.
Granted, I know that, but isn't it a nice backup to have? Because there are many variations in anatomy. So that's just one of hundreds of examples that I can make. So sorry. Sorry, Ray Ban. It's a good, I mean, I like it. I think it's pretty cool, right? Like, hey, take a photo, take a video, share the story. That's pretty fun. But Facebook, I don't know.
It's not changing healthcare, not evolving healthcare. I did want to talk about one evolution in healthcare. This is something that I've kind of heard about. And, you know, I'm always interested in asking about it. So healthcare is traditionally this service-driven or disease-driven industry that's trying to, or that people are trying to push towards more outcomes or consumer-driven industry. You know, you mentioned this, like in private practice, people want a consumer experience. They want to be able to pick and choose, and they want to be able to pick and choose the best experience for them. What are your thoughts on the current state of this evolution? And is it better in hospitals versus like solo clinics? I think you already answered that. And obviously you lean towards the solo groups, but yeah, are hospitals trending that way too? Is there any hope there? What are your thoughts?
I saw evidence-based outcome medicine kind of come in, birth itself and come into place in the hospitals. I'm going to lean back on ancient wisdom. The wrong person using the right means makes the right means work in the wrong way. I like metaphors and analogies, and then I can get into the weeds if needed, but you know, on a podcast, I think the platform doesn't have time for that, but I'm absolutely willing to engage in that. Whoever wants to have a conversation about it. So let's look at Boeing and SpaceX. Boeing is a veteran in the industry. Boeing has an incredibly tenured, historical, experienced basis for building phenomenal machines that fly, because you know, space is just flight, right? It's just a different kind of flight. What happened is it's the approach and the methodology and the philosophy. A, there's a visionary at SpaceX. There is not at Boeing. It's what we call design by committee. And that is what outcome medicine is failing to do. It's design by committee. And design by committee, the problem is you've got a lot of fingers in the cookie jar. And so the information is not magical. I mean, you get a knee replacement and you want it to work well. In my line of work, you get a bunionectomy and you want it to work well, right? You want it to heal well. You don't want infections. That's one of the benefits of my private practice model. I don't have the financial limitations imposed upon me by a financially driven hospital business model. If I want to buy the newest equipment because it's the latest and greatest and it cuts down potential for necrosis on the bone when I'm cutting it, or if I'm buying the latest and greatest diagnostic equipment or the latest and greatest infection control products, they're costly, but I use those because I want to, because they reduce my infection rates. Something as simple, like we use an alginate product, a dressing that delivers silver ions to the wound as it gets moist. And it's a product that I encountered first in my training in the wound care days. Well, it's an expensive product per use. It's like maybe $5, $6, $10, I think. Well, okay. So if you're using a lot of that in a hospital, what's going to happen is going to be like, how come you're using that? That's expensive. Why are you using that? I mean, hospitals are constantly cost cutting, right? Because they have a profit. that's necessary because they're a private corporation. So it's a very convoluted conversation to have when it comes to outcomes. I think the outcome-based perspective is a good one. I just think the way it's being done right now, that's why we're not seeing fantastic results out of it. Like so full disclosure, I wound up in the hospital a year and a half ago, March of last year, with COVID. Mm-hmm. I was in a hospital dying with COVID. And it was horrible. And it was an eye-opener because I was in cruise control mode for the past year before that. And I thought, I think there's a reason behind me being here because this sucks being in here. I mean, not the COVID part. Yeah, the COVID part sucks, right? And the anguish of that. But like, why is it such a crappy experience? Why does the food suck?
Yeah.
I'm sick. I need nourishment.
Right.
And I'll tell you why it sucks is because it's designed by committee and it's budgetarily driven. It's all that stuff that happens in these big organizations. One person's voice gets drowned by all sorts of corporate intention. You know, I mean, I'm sure you've sat in meetings at different companies you worked in where people have personal intentions for moving up the ladder. And so there's all sorts of like buying and politics that go on. And that's humanity. That's why I say AI is going to save us from ourselves.
Right.
Well, because it's going to get rid of that nonsense. It's like, no, like Karen, you're wrong. Like Denise, you're wrong. You know, Charles, you're incorrect. This is the correct path. There's no discussion. So this is the correct path. Now, historically, when we do that as people, we're like, well, wait a minute. What are you? You're the authority. Like, who says you're right? And so I think outcome models only work when you eliminate the human greed and the human intention and the profit motives and all that nonsense. Just get it out of the way and just look for pure outcomes. And now layer in experience because experience is critical. Look, the only thing you have in this world on your brief infinitesimal little blip of time on this little speck of dust orbiting around a ball of fire, the only thing you have of worth is your experience. Nothing else matters. What you experience during your lifetime matters. And that's not some romantic poetry. That is the foundation for what doctors have a responsibility to purvey. I'm going to give you a shot because you have a thing that needs a shot, an injection. Mm-hmm. Okay, I can just give you a shot and say, I don't have time. I have a lot of patients. Suck it up. It's going to hurt. Or I can have time and take care of you as a person and treat you the way you need to be treated and treat the next person. The next person, they don't have any fear. They don't even care. Jam the shot and get it over with. Move on. That latitude of human experience is what I'm talking about in reference and in comparison to the outcome-driven conversation. When we just start leaning in like a bunch of lemmings running towards the outcome model, we forget the humanity. And isn't that what created Apple, the crossroads of humanities and technology? So that's the problem I have with the like high level terminologies about like outcome models and stuff. Now, I think you mentioned something. I don't mean to like just pull out your next question for me, but something about like Amazon and the big players providing healthcare. Is that something you were going to ask me about, I think?
I was going to ask who's going to evolve healthcare. Yeah.
I'm actually super excited about that because look at what Amazon's done with groceries. I mean, look, I know big box and it's potentially dangerous, but I'm going to trust that big box in the right hands is going to be really great for humanity. I mean, look at Apple. Apple is the biggest box you can see. So is Tesla. Mm-hmm. And look how fantastic they are. You know, I'm so thrilled. I got this Model Y and Tesla offers car insurance. And I think that that's a really great play because the car has to, obviously the car is collecting data, right? Every gas, like every time you step on the accelerator, it's not a gas pedal anymore, it's an accelerator. How you step on the accelerator, how quickly you step on the accelerator, like the threshold from how quickly you go from 1 to 10, how you brake, if you brake, how you turn, where you turn, how you turn, well, all the little intricacies. And then what's that going to turn into soon? A very granular and an accurate actuarial model to price your car insurance, isn't it?
Yeah.
That's cool, man. So that's like in healthcare. It's like, hey, are you eating burgers all day? Your insurance, why? I'm a very healthy 50-year-old. Why do I have to pay the same premium as a person who's eating all this bad food and not exercising? Mm-hmm. So this kind of dovetails into your earlier question about exciting things like wearables. So I recently got an email from United Healthcare, our insurer in our office. We provide insurance for our team members. And myself included. And it's like, hey, you have a Peloton, connect your Peloton and then connect your Apple Watch. And I'm like, I see the play. That's a good play. Good job, guys. High five, right? That over there, I think the insurer is doing a good thing. High five, because I'm going to be exercising on my Peloton and they're going to see my Apple Watch data just like I can see patients' Apple Watch data. Thank you, Dr. Chrono. Thank you, Apple, for the health app integration. And so I know what my patient's doing. United Healthcare sees how active you are. They say, hey, Ali Sadri is living a healthy lifestyle. Your premium gets a 30% discount. Thanks, United Healthcare. Now, that seems like an episode out of Black Mirror. It's a little bit, for some people, it's funny. My friend and I were chatting over the Amazon Astro Dog, and he's like, you know, what bothers me is I tell people I ordered the Astro Dog, and people were like, I don't know about that. It's like, listen, it's happened. Tech is here. Get over it. Integrate. Blend in. Let's all use the tech for our benefit. And so I'm very enthusiastic and excited about the right players who are not really health players like Amazon, like Apple, getting into the space. I read an article somewhere about Apple. It would be natural for Apple to open up health clinics. And I thought I'd be one of the first doctors. I've always been a private guy, right? I'd be one of the first doctors to sign up and work at an Apple clinic. Because Apple's shown time and time again that the ethos, the integrity behind how they develop a product is there. Do they make missteps? Of course they do. Like everyone. I mean, what? No human makes mistakes? Of course they make mistakes. They rectify the mistake and they move on, right? So I think there's something really special about these players getting into the healthcare space and offering healthcare solutions. Have you been to one of the new Amazon? I forget the name, what they call them. I went to one in San Francisco where you don't really pay, you just walk out.
Oh, I have not, like the walk-in stores or something.
Yeah. They're so, I forget what it's called, not Amazon Fresh, but Amazon something. And it's the coolest experience. It's like, wow, this is magical. It's like the iPhone. It's like the first time, when I first experienced one of those, it was like I experienced an iPhone. I was like, wow, this is so interesting. I get to walk in here and walk out of here. And, you know, a lot of we're all very polite. We're members of a society, as citizens of, you know, the modern world society. But there's something to be said about not dealing with people that's very refreshing. Like, it, not like doctors, not like pilots, flight attendants. I'm talking about that. I'm talking about the stuff, the level that is kind of like unnecessary, like the Uber driver. Nobody really wants an Uber driver, right? And here's evidence of that. Now you get to set your preferences in the Uber app. I want it cool in the car and I want no conversation.
Right. Right.
Well, if any of you people are one of the low-level Uber developers, anybody, whoever's listening, can you add like smell? Because I can't stand when I get an Uber and it like smells so pungent of like the air freshener. My nose hairs are burning. I'm like, oh God, too much air freshener, buddy.
We'll get there.
Right? And yeah. So that's the thing. It's like, so I think those players that understand user experience like Amazon, because as evidenced by these markets and by Amazon delivery and just the whole experience is just beautiful. Look, Amazon bought Whole Foods. Everybody was like, oh my gosh, you're going to ruin it. I personally think Whole Foods is better now that Amazon bought it than it was before. If you go into some of the newer Whole Foods, I live in Southern California, and you go into some of the newer Whole Foods here, like the one in Playa Vista, it's just so cool. It's incredible. It's beautiful. They've got the Amazon muscle behind them to create these incredibly sophisticated and modern experiences for the purchasing of food items, and organized, tidy, and clean.
All right. So we're excited about those big players in healthcare. We'll see who's going to stick around. All right. Well, that's all we got time for today. To the listeners, thank you for sticking with us until the end there. And Ali, you know, thank you for coming on, sharing your time, sharing your wisdom. I really take a lot out of these conversations. So thank you so much. Until next time, this has been On the Health Record.
It's always a privilege to be with you. Thank you.
That's all we have for this episode. If you liked it, share it with a friend. You can also help us out by leaving a rating and reviewing the podcast on Apple Podcast or Spotify. We'd also love to hear your feedback. If you have any questions, comments, or ideas on who I should talk to next, you can email me directly at oleg.koujikov@drchrono.com. Thanks to everyone that helped put this episode together, including Alyse DiNapoli, Jon Murphy, and Dan Kivatinos. Thanks for listening. Have a great rest of your day.